Okay, I'm going to make this particular lecture very informal. I don't have any typed up slides for it. I hopefully will have typed up slides for most of the rest of the lectures. Generally speaking, we can say that the field of quantum information deals with the precise manipulation of individual quantum states. And in the early days of the subject, it was natural to assume that this means that really you would only deal with objects which had the characteristics. First of all, their properties are exactly and uniquely specified. For example, one calcium atom is essentially identical to any other calcium atom. Secondly, you know the individual microstates with a fair amount of confidence. And thirdly, your initial or reference state is uniquely specified, or at least very accurately specified. For example, you know that you're starting off your calcium atom as its ground state. And at first sight, that would seem to mean that in quantum information, which I'm taking a broad sense to include quantum computing, quantum cryptography, anything else you'd like to think of under those headings, you'd think you'd be dealing with basically atomic level entities, nuclear spins, trapped ions, photons, atoms, whatever. By contrast, if you think about the field of condensed matter physics, then it's traditionally very messy. Indeed. First of all, if I have two blocks, say, of niobium sitting on my lab bench, they're not identical. We don't know the properties in microscopic detail. We probably don't even know the exact chemical composition, and we certainly don't know where the various impurities, dislocations, etc. are. Moreover, it's sitting on some kind of lab bench, which is vibrating and subject to all sorts of noise, etc. Secondly, you don't know the exact quantum mechanical states of your system. Almost by definition, if you have a complex many-body system, it has 10 to the 80th degrees of freedom, you're certainly not going to know what all those are. And thirdly, you, in general, you don't know the initial state of your system. Typically, what you do in traditional condensed matter physics is to specify that by some kind of Gibbs distribution. But that's a probability distribution. It doesn't specify a unique state. It just specifies probabilities. So at first sight, it does look, and did look 15 years ago, that really condensed matter physics is not going to be particularly relevant to quantum information. However, that has changed, as most of you will be aware. It's changed quite drastically over the last 15 years. What's happened? Well, I think we've come to a number of realizations. First of all, many of the unknowns may actually not matter very much. And in particular, and this is, I think, is perhaps the most spectacular thing. If we just go back to the late 90s, for example, there was a general impression that if you were dealing with complex condensed matter systems, and in particular, if you're dealing with any kind of property of those systems which you could reasonably call macroscopic, like, say, the flux threading, what we used to call an RF squid, and nowadays we call a flux qubit. If you think about the possibility of observing quantum behavior of this kind of degree of freedom, in the late 90s, and for many years before, there was a general impression was that this is totally ridiculous, by their nature, many body systems were just so complex and fragile and so forth that it was totally hopeless to look for anything. In fact, I'm actually told that when one of the experimental groups was starting the first experiments to look for what we would now call macroscopic quantum coherence in a flux qubit around 1999, a very senior and respected theoretical colleague of the group in question assured them they were just wasting the taxpayers' money. It's clear nothing like this was ever going to be observable. Well, because as many of you will know, nowadays it's almost completely routine. The point where people have forgotten there was ever a problem really in doing this. So what's changed? Well, as I say, one thing that's been realised is that an awful lot of the mess, as it were, which is associated with condensed matter systems may be irrelevant to the purposes you want. And there's, and in particular, the naive back of envelope estimates of decoherence, which people used to make in the 90s, turn out to be wildly overestimates. In fact, I would say until perhaps 10 years ago, just about every estimate of decoherence in a macroscopic many-body system in the literature was overestimating decoherence by literally tens of orders of magnitude. Nowadays, in some sense, the pendulum swung the other way. Now, if anything, I think people tend to underestimate decoherence, but certainly traditionally it was grossly overestimated. We'll come back in a moment to specific reasons why that was so. The second realization, I think, has been that compared with the sort of traditional microsystems like, say, nuclear spins or trapped ions or whatever, or even photons, classical condensed matter systems, and in particular the sort of macroscopic condensed matter systems like flux qubits and so forth, may actually be considerably easier to engineer. This is partly, of course, simply because we've had 100 years' worth of experience of classical electrical engineering dealing with them. But there are other factors which come in as well. Their mere macroscopic nature, in some sense, makes it sometimes easier to deal with them. The third thing, I think, and perhaps the most exciting, relevant realization over the last 10, 15 years, has been that one may actually be able to exploit the complexity of many-body systems to good effect in quantum information. And this is, of course, particularly been so in the idea of topological quantum computing, where you actually you regard, in some sense, the complexity of the many-body wave function as an advantage to be used in trying to protect your information. So in fact, there has, I think, been a rather happy convergence of traditional condensed matter theory and experiment and of quantum information over the last 10 or 15 years or so. And that's why I'm giving this course, basically. But I think one has to be aware of the dangers. The whole aim of the two fields really historically has been very different. I mean, traditional condensed matter physics, by and large, has been devoted to trying to calculate macroscopic thermodynamic properties of the systems you're talking about. Now, of course, this might be either static properties, like, say, the specific heat, or they might be transport properties, like the electrical resistivity of your system, whatever. In either case, you're really, in some sense, prepared to average over a great deal of the microscopic behaviour. You're only interested in the macroscopic outcome of that. There have been, there are cases in more traditional condensed matter physics where one's tried to do something in some sense a little more microscopic. For example, when you do STM measurements on a superconductor, you're looking at particular vortices, you want to look at the structure of the energy states in that vortex. But even then, you're really averaging over a fairly long period of time in your measurement. Again, you're really, in some sense, interested only in the averaged information. So typically, you don't, if the quantities you're measuring are, let's say, of order n, as it were, where n is the total number of particles in your system, you're not too concerned with the fluctuations. The fluctuations are only of order n to the half. So this would be 10 to the 15 versus 10 to the 30th. Who's caring about that? You're not really. By contrast, quantum information typically deals, by its nature, with the very delicate properties of individual quantum states. And I think, therefore, it's you want to follow the development of a single quantum state with extreme precision. So this means that if in fact your description of the system is incomplete, that incompleteness had better not affect the state development. In some sense, it should factor out. And indeed, in the traditional microscopic systems like photons, nuclear spins, ions, and so forth, generally speaking, it does factor out to a good approximation. For example, there are good arguments to say that when you're interested in doing your quantum computing, say using nuclear spins, the fact that these nuclear spins, in fact, are actually interacting with phonons and so forth is really not of great importance, because the interaction is too weak to be relevant. But that's not at all so clear when you're dealing with a more complex and robust many-body system of the kind that you nowadays we often do. And I think one thing that one has to be very careful, I'll be coming back to this point sort of fairly repeatedly during this this course, is that, as I say, the whole objectives of the two fields have really historically been rather different. There have been a large number of calculational techniques which have been developed in traditional condensed matter theory, for example, Green's function, functional integral techniques, dot, 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 you name it. These have, by and large, I think one can say, these have been rather successful in predicting or enabling us to calculate the macroscopic behavior of our many-body systems. It doesn't follow that these are necessarily going to be quite so successful when we come to the much more delicate calculations we want to do in quantum information. And I think there's been a rather dangerous tendency to take over a large number of these tried and tested techniques of many-body physics and simply apply them routinely to quantum information problems without adequate examination. For example, there's a very, as many of you know, there's a very, very old and by now pretty well tried and trusted technique in many-body physics known as the Green's function technique. This was basically evolved primarily by Japanese and Russian theorists way back in the 50s and 60s, so it's been around for a long, long time. And nowadays, almost without question, when people are doing, say, calculations on, let us take, just take as an example, the sorts of excitations that might occur in strontium ruthenate and might be useful for topological quantum computing, the so-called Majorana fermions, there's been an almost automatic tendency to simply take over those techniques without much examination. Now, in fact, as far as I know, it has never been satisfactorily established that the fact that you can write down a string of Green's functions, you can make approximations to the solution, you can even show that these approximations are asymptotically exact in the infinite volume in the thermodynamic limit. It's never been shown that this guarantees you've actually got a wave function which corresponds to those. In fact, there's a famous bit of history which I suspect how many of you have heard of the Gorkov-Galitsky paper on anisotropic Fermi superfluids? No, I thought not. As a matter of fact, very few people, even in the sort of even professionally in the many body field, know about it. Let me tell you a little story about this, because I think it is a cautionary tale, though not quite as cautionary as I originally thought it was. We go back to the days of the late 50s, early 60s, okay, following the Bodie and Cooper-Schrieffer theory of superconductivity. Now, of course, Bodie and Cooper-Schrieffer was for electrons which form Cooper pairs with total angular momentum zero. But people really rather soon came to realise that this is not the only possibility, that you might be able, under certain circumstances, it might be energetically advantageous for the Cooper pairs to form with angular momentum different from zero, say one or two. And there was a strong feeling around that in the case, which turned out in the end to be incorrect, but that's another story, there's a strong feeling around that in the case of liquid helium-3, which is in many ways qualitatively very like the system of electrons in metals, that this might form its Cooper pairs in a state with angular momentum 2. And so this became a subject of quite intense study. And there's a famous paper by Anderson and Morell in, I think, 1961, which basically takes the BCS theory and writes down the most obvious generalization of it to the case where the pairing is with angular momentum 2. And they came out with a number of interesting results, and in particular they came out with the result that the rotational, in such a system, in three dimensions, the rotational symmetry must automatically get broken, so you'd have some kind of characteristic axis picked out. This was sort of interesting, but also in some sense rather inelegant. In some sense, I think a lot of people had the gut feeling that since the original problem was completely isotropic, there ought to be some kind of nice isotropic solution to it, even in the case of D-wave pairing, L equals 2. And in fact, a few months after the Anderson-Morell paper, there came out a paper by Gorkov and Galitsky, two very distinguished Soviet theorists, which said, essentially, we have got a much nicer and more isotropic and elegant solution. And what they'd done was they'd basically the BCS, original BCS Hamiltonian, probably generalized to the case of non-zero angular momentum pairing. They'd written down a chain of Green's function equations. So these are equations not for any wave function, but for the Green's functions of the system. And they'd shown, following an argument of Bogolyubov in the S-wave case, that at a particular level of the hierarchy of Green's function equations, you could make a decoupling which was asymptotically exact in the thermodynamic limit. So they went ahead and made this decoupling. And lo and behold, what came out was a beautifully isotropic state, which appeared to have all sorts of nice properties. And they were certainly very happy about it, and I suspect a lot of the readers were very happy about it. The only problem was, very soon after this appeared, there were a couple of papers came out. One was by Nossener, Balian and Wertheimer, and the other by Hone, which showed that this couldn't possibly be right. The way they essentially established this was to take a toy model problem, which had all, as it were, the topological features of the problem that was under consideration, the D-wave L equals 2 pairing problem. And they were able to establish not just, because it's rather usually rather straightforward, to establish upper limits of the ground state energy of a many-body system by just using some kind of variational trial wave function. In this case, they could actually do better than that. They could establish a lower limit on the ground state energy. They then went through the analogue of the procedure of Gorkov and Galitsky and showed that this violated the lower bound. So there had to be something wrong. Now, Gorkov and Bellion and Wertheimer, when they wrote their original paper, they actually came out explicitly and said, what this shows is that a consistent solution of the chain of Green's function equations does not establish that there is a Schrodinger wave function underlying that. They later hedged their bets somewhat on this, following the work of Hone. They said, it turned out, and Hone pointed this out, that although you, as it were, you could cut off the chain of Green's functions at this point, you need not do so, and if you did not do so, then you could go to a higher order and show that the Gorkov-Galitsky solution was false. So, in other words, within the Green's function approach, if you went to a high enough order, you could show that their solution didn't work. But nevertheless, I think that's a sort of fairly severe cautionary lesson for us. Never been proved, to my knowledge at least, that simply writing down a whole chain of Green's functions, showing that you have a consistent solution of them, guarantees that there is an underlying wave function for that. So I think you really do have to be rather careful about that. Let's just talk a little about the general description of a typical condensed matter problem. The sort of problem might be interesting in quantum information context. Generally speaking, you have some kind of system that you're interested in, and then perhaps you might have something that you would like to treat as a qubit, like, say, a particular nuclear spin or the electron in a nitrogen vacancy complex, or trapped ion or something. And then you have all the rest of the universe with which, in some sense, it's interacting. Typically, we just call this the environment. So basically, the environment is everything which you really rather not have to think about, but do have to think about because it's going to affect the behavior of the system you're primarily interested in. Typically, in a condensed matter system, as distinct from, say, quantum optics, the system environment interaction is almost always strong. So that raises the question, how come that you can ever treat a typical condensed matter system as in any sense isolated? And I think one very important consideration, which I think was not really appreciated when people did these hand-waving back-of-envelope calculations way back in the 90s, is the phenomenon which is sometimes called false decoherence. This is, I think, a rather important topic, so let me just spend a rather generic phenomenon. So let me just take a few minutes talking about that. Incidentally, please do interrupt at any time if you feel that what I'm saying is not clear or you have any questions. False, as distinct from true, yes. Okay, let's think a little about the following problem. You have a neutron and you're going to do a typical neutron interferometer experiment. So, very schematically, you might have your reactor, your source of neutrons, somewhere around here, say, your neutron comes out, and you're interested in the neutrons which is not literally two slits, in fact, but effectively corresponds to that. You have some kind of effective Young slits device. Your neutron's going to go through here, and all through here, also not here, and what you're going to do is to look for the interference. So nothing particularly fancy about this, basically a standard Young slits experiment done with neutrons. Many such experiments have been done. Now, how do you how do we analyze this this experiment? Well, very crudely and schematically, the way that the sort of standard textbook discussion would usually analyze it is to say that by the time you've got to the neighborhood of the intermediate screen here, you have some amplitude psi A, and let's call this slit A and this one B, some psi A of X, to have the neutron up here, and you have some amplitude psi B of X to have it here. And then you discuss the propagation of these amplitudes and show that in general you get contributions from both of them here, and therefore you do get the standard interference effects. Okay. Well, so far nothing looks peculiar, but can anyone see anything wrong with that picture? They're interacting with, yes indeed, they're interacting with the screen, which may be an important factor, but I was going to point out something else, namely that they're also interacting with the electromagnetic environment. Why? Well, after all, the neutron does have a spin and has a magnetic moment associated with that spin. So that magnetic moment is interacting with the photon, the black body radiation field. So in fact, the correct description of the here is not by a pure state, but by a state which the neutron is, the whole thing is not by a pure state, just the sum of this and this, but rather by an entangled state in which there's associated here some, let's call it phi, phi A, some state of the radiation field, and here some state of the radiation field. So in other words, the neutron itself does not have a pure state when it gets there. It's entangled with its environment, and in general, if you just stick to the neutron, it has to be described by a mixture, not by a pure state. Now, of course, exactly how much it's entangled, that depends on what you assume about the details of the coupling to the radiation field. For example, the higher the essential form factor, which will cut off the interaction at high energy and so forth. But in principle, that's certainly there. And there are many other cases in condensed matter physics where that kind of effect is much, much stronger, where the entanglement with the environment is much stronger. Let's just suppose, for the sake of argument, that the entanglement is sort of substantial. As I say, it will depend on how you cut things off, what the size of the device is, etc. But let's suppose it's substantial, so that the off-diagonal elements of your density matrix are substantially reduced, say, let's say by 50%. Okay? Does that mean we are not going to see full visibility of our... Why not? Anyone?
That
might be one way of putting it. I think the way I would have tended to put it is that this is basically an adiabatic effect. That is the dressing of the neutron, or neutron spin by the radiation field does not involve emission of real photons, at least only to a very tiny extent. You started off with a pure state of your neutron here. By the time you get here, it's now become this entangled state. As the two wave packets propagate back to the screen here, they come back into coincidence, you see. And so here, the state of the radiation field, phi A, associated with this branch, coincides with the state phi B. So in some sense, the radiation field, as it were, slaved to the motion of the neutron, and automatically comes back into coincidence with it. This is, as I say, a very common situation in condensed matter physics. So common, in fact, that we tend not to notice it occurring at all. But in almost every condensed matter system, you have this kind of strong interaction with your environment, and in many such systems, it doesn't matter. Now, it would matter, of course. What would matter is if there were a substantial probability of emitting a real photon. at either of the slits. And if, moreover, the slits are sufficiently far apart and the wavelength of the photon is small enough that it can act as a genuine which-way detector. This, incidentally, is a very nice feature which comes out. How many of you are familiar with the Vienna molecular interference experiments, the C60 and things like that? No? Okay, let me just say a word about those, because that's, I think, quite relevant in this context. These beautiful series of experiments that have been carried out originally by with Anton Zeilinger leading it, and nowadays with Marcus Arndt, the principal leader of this group, in Vienna. And they are on basically standard young slits experiments, with carried out with complex molecules. This, as a matter of fact, this subject goes back. This is a bit of history, which you might be amused by. Somebody goes back a long way. Does anyone know when the first essentially young slits experiments were carried out, not on single particles like electrons or single electrons or photons or neutrons, but on molecules, in this case H2 molecules? Anyone like to guess a date for that? It's actually 1928, I think. almost immediately after the original Davis-Inger type experiments. But they sort of stuck at this level, the level of H2, for many, many years. And in recent years, since about 2000, Marcus Arndt's group and Anton Zeilinger's group have been able to do these experiments on really quite complex molecules like C60, C70, and even nowadays some small molecules of biological significance. So now there are many interesting things about those experiments, but one here's one rather nice point. Since these are indeed complex objects, they have all sorts of excitations which single electrons and atoms don't have. In particular, they have vibrational modes, and some of these modes, not a lot, but some of them are actually infrared active. In other words, these modes can couple to the blackbody radiation field, they can emit and absorb photons. And if you figure out the temperature, you might think that to do this experiment successfully, you'd have to go down to sort of cryogenic temperatures. Not at all. You can actually start off with your oven out of which the C60s are emerging at somewhere around 1,000 degrees, in fact, 100,000. So some of these vibrational modes are actually thermally excited by the time the C60s come out of the oven. Now, they have a chance of, we can figure out what is the probability that one of these modes will basically emit a photon, come to the radiation field and emit a photon during the process of transit through the experiment. And it turns out that probably half a dozen such events as you go through. Now, at first sight, that's a puzzle, because after all, that at first sight, that should act as a which-way detector. Nevertheless, you see, the actual pattern of the diffraction is not as nice and sharp as it is in photon or even electron young slits experiment, but it's recognisably a diffraction pattern, nevertheless, or an interference pattern, rather. How come? Yeah, that's right. Yes, yes. If you figure it out, you know the frequency of these modes. You know the wavelength of the corresponding photons. That wavelength is large in the original experiments. It's large compared to the distance between the slits. So it does not act as an efficient which-way detector, and therefore does not destroy the interference. In a later paper, this is Hackenmiller et al. Around 2006, I think. They actually prettied up this experiment by, first of all, heating the oven to a higher temperature, and secondly, more importantly, by spacing the slits larger by about a factor of 10. Sure enough, the interference went away. So I think that's a beautiful illustration of the sort of principles behind which-way detection there. Anyway, I digress. I was talking. Yep. I was talking about false decoherence. As I say, let me emphasise again. This is a very, very generic feature of condensed matter systems. In fact, it's very difficult, to be honest, it's very difficult to think of any condensed matter system where this isn't to some extent or other happening. But luckily, as I say, it tends out not to matter too much. A second point, which is important to appreciate, is that in certain circumstances, at least, even though your many-body system is highly complex and subject to all sorts of interactions, there may be what we might call a certain amount of topological protection going on. Now, I think nowadays there's a tendency to think of anything which has the word topological in it as having started maybe sometime around 2004 or 2005 with the big burst of excitement about topological insulators and so forth. But actually, these ideas about the importance of topology in physics go back a long, long way. And not just in particle in field theory. In particle physics, they've obviously been around a long time, but also in condensed matter physics. And here's a typical example. It's probably not, for practical reasons, very relevant directly to quantum information, but it's an old and simple example. Suppose you I take a... take an annulus here. And I put in that annulus liquid helium, say. Let's see, what am I going to do? Well, I think what I will do is I'll start off by rotating my bucket. Okay, so I'll put it on an old-fashioned gramophone turntable or something of the kind, and I will rotate it. And the helium will be at sort of some fairly high temperature, say 3 or 4 degrees. So it's basically much like water. So what's water going to do when you put it on this this kind of device? You will know. It'll start rotating. Yeah, it'll take a little time, but it'll start rotating. Yep. Okay. And eventually, after, in the case, if you do it, I've actually done this experiment just to make, although I'm a theorist, I do find it necessary occasionally just to verify that some contact with the real world. So I've actually done this experiment with a glass of water or a gramophone turntable, and about a minute it comes into rotation with the rotating container. Okay, so now you've got it rotating. Now you cool the helium down, and in particular you cool it down past the so-called lambda point where it becomes superfluid. And at that point, the liquid, or at least a large part of it, does in fact become superfluid, but you hardly notice that. If you're rotating fast enough, you hardly notice. It'll still try to do its best to keep up with the rotating container. It won't. It probably won't make it exactly, but in the superfluid state, but it'll make it pretty close. Having done that, I now stop the container. And now, of course, what is remarkable is that since the liquid is superfluid, it'll go on rotating for essentially as long as I want to look at it. And the question is why? And the answer is basically a topological one. It's not, I emphasize, the reason the liquid continues to rotate even after the container has stopped has very, very little to do with any kind of lack of contact with the walls. I mean, you can make the walls very rough and so forth, so that water, I mean, if I do the experiment with water, of course, once I stop rotating the glass, the water will also come to rest in the lab frame. But the superfluid won't. This is very little to do with any kind of smoothness of the container or anything like that. You can make it pretty much as rough as you like, and this will still happen. Okay? So basically, the explanation is that, or at least this all. Standard textbook level explanation is that in the superfluid state, the liquid is described by a so-called order parameter, which has the general nature of a Schrodinger wave function. The difference is that this particular wave function is associated with the behavior of a large diffraction of the particle. You've basically got the helium atoms in the superfluid phase are basically undergo both condensation, and therefore they must all occupy the same state, and in this case they're occupying a particular state which corresponds to the rotation. So now, let's say, what if you just had a single particle which is rotating in this geometry, carrying a finite circulating current, what would that wave function look like? Well, crudely speaking, very schematically, if the angle around the container is phi, psi would go as e to the I L phi, where L is some integer number, right? Is actually the angular momentum of that particle, right? And basically the superfluid does the same, except that now there are a large number of the order of the total number of particles are actually all in this state here.
Mm. Is that the reason why it needs to be in a ring shape? Because in the center of the
face may be fine? Right. Yes, I could have just had a bucket, a single bucket here, but you're right, the phase will not be defined and you get a vortex sitting there. Which is very often the real-life situation, but it's just a little complication for the sake of the argument here.
Question. Yep. So suppose we imagined an infinitely long trough.
Yes.
Fluid in.
Yes, yes.
Supercooled and have the trough running in one.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be the same kind of topology.
No. You're right, yes. That's a slightly delicate point, actually. Experimentally, that's certainly the case. Now you'd have to basically, what one basically has to argue there is that, in some sense, what's controlled experimentally is the relative phase of the superfluid at the two ends. And you control that by, say, putting on a pressure gradient or something of the kind. And so effectively, because you've fixed the relative phase, then effectively that's the same as having a multiple connected topology. But I think it's conceptually simpler to discuss this one. Interesting, again, forgive me if I keep going off in these historical excursions, but I thought it might be amusing. How many of you have looked at the original 1911 paper where Kamerling on his, or actually more precisely his lab assistant, discovered superconductivity? Anyone looked at that? You have, I think, Dominic, haven't you? Yeah? Okay. Interesting question, you see. He, in some sense, did what you said. He didn't have a complete superconducting annular geometry. What he did have was, crudely speaking, a circuit in which I think there was something like copper, and then you have a bit of the circuit which is mercury in his case, and then you have more copper, and you're basically driving a constant current through this circuit and measuring the voltage drop across the mercury. And of course, what you see is that at room temperature, it's some nice value. Ohm's law is obeyed very nicely with a finite resistance. Then, as you go to below four degrees, the voltage drops to zero. So basically, zero resistance here. Now, a question which has always intrigued me: when you're talking about superconductivity, as some of you might know, you basically have a simple phenomenon which corresponds to the helium case. That is, you can set up a current in a ring and it'll go on circulating essentially forever. Right? Then you have something a little more complicated, which is the Meissner effect, which basically means, well, the spectacular effect, of course, is that the magnetic field is expelled, but the phenomenon underlying that is that the system becomes a perfect diamagnet. In other words, a small magnetic vector potential applied to it induces a finite current. Now, it's an interesting question whether in the original Kamerling-Onnes experiment he was seeing, which of these effects he was seeing. The difference is, the conceptual difference is important. The conceptual difference is that this, for any reasonable value of L, whether in the helium or the superconductor case, this has to be a metastable effect. You can actually demonstrate quite explicitly, it's a very simple calculation, that the ground state, if the walls are at rest, the ground state has to have lower energy than the circulating state. So this has to be a metastable state. On the other hand, what you're seeing in the Meissner effect, and you would actually see if you actually rotated your container here very slowly, not very fast. If you rotate your container very slowly, so slowly in fact that angular frequency is less than h bar over 2mr. There's a strong condition. I mean, if you put in realistic numbers for that, that means your frequency has to be of the order of one per day or something like that. But if you could do that, then what you'd see is that the liquid stays at rest in the lab frame. Okay? This is the analog of the Meissner effect in superconductors.
When you say it stays at rest, that means that you start rotating the fluid is rotating with the container.
Okay. Yes,
yes,
yes, that's right, yes. And does it, okay, now, of course, you, if you think about it, you say, wait a minute, the Earth's frame is not actually an inertial frame. What happens if we do the experiment at the North Pole? So does it rotate once a day or not? In other words, is it at rest in the frame of the laboratory or in the frame of the fixed stars? And the evidence is consistent. I don't think anyone's really experimentally really answered that question definitively, but all the evidence is consistent with it coming to rest in the frame of the fixed stars. Rather amazing if you come to think about it.
Is it just at rest with respect to itself?
Sorry?
Is it just at rest with respect to itself, the two sides not moving past one another or anything?
Well, no, I think as viewed from the frame of the Earth, they are, actually. So, at least, assuming. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Anyway, sorry. Okay, sorry, I'm digressing quite a lot. But So as I say, one has to create the crucial distinction between this failure to rotate under very small rotations, which is a thermal equilibrium effect. And the persistent currents with a large value of the circulating velocity, that's a metastable effect. And in my mind, I think it's a scandal that many textbooks on superconductivity fail to distinguish these two things. It's a crucial distinction between, and we'll see in a moment, one aspect of this. Anyway, so did good old Camerlingonis or Flim, his lab assistant, did he actually... was he actually seeing the Meissner effect, a stable equilibrium phenomenon, or was he seeing essentially the phenomenon of supercurrent metastability? And the answer is we don't know. He doesn't give enough detail in the original paper. So it could have been either. Luckily, of course, in the light of history, all that's irrelevant because many, many further experiments. So anyway, coming back to the helium. Okay, you've got all these all these atoms, a large fraction of the whole, condensed into the single state, which is rotating. Now, why is that rotation persistent? After all, if I were to put a single particle in there, I mean we have a sort of similar example, say of an electron in an excited state in the atom, so say in a p state. If I put if I excite an electron in an atom into a p state, what's going to happen? Not going to stay there. Right? It'll decay. It'll decay rather fast, actually. It'll decay with a lifetime of something like 10 to the minus 9 seconds, in fact. So why doesn't the... I think one can fairly easily convince oneself that even if the geometry is macroscopic like this, and you put a single particle in here, and it had any sort of reasonable probability of, say, exciting a photon in the walls, or if it's charged, exciting, emitting a photon, it's going to do so pretty quickly. Whereas in real life, I mean, you know, the lifetime of the, I don't know if it's there's really been any definitive limit set for helium, but for superconductors, the lifetime of the circulating current state is way, way above the age of the universe. So why does it stay in this state? And the answer is, this has been realized for many, many decades, the answer is basically topological. Imagine this phase. So let's try to think of a sort of physical model to visualize what's going on here. Think of this phase, or think of the wave function as like a string. Imagine you have a hula hoop, say, around your waist. You've tied a string around that hula hoop. You're winding it around, okay? So the phase here is like the angle which the string is making with some reference axis as it goes around. So it's going around many times as I come around. Now, if I suppose I've done this, I've wound the string around, tied the ends back together again, okay? And now imagine that I'm shuffling the string around. I can shuffle it as much as I like, and in other words, I can change the value of the phase at any particular point as much as I like. But one thing I'm never going to be able to change is the number of turns. That's a simple topological theorem. Right? The only circumstance in which I'm going to be able to change the number of turns is if I cut the string. So the analog of that in the case of the atom or the helium is that I have to depress the amplitude of my wave function to zero. If I can do that, then obviously the phase is sort of undefined, and I can slip, I can slip 2 pi or whatever, however many 2 pi's I want.
Does this kind of beg the question, though? I mean,
Well, no, actually, I mean, if I were to, okay, let's, for the moment, I think it's slightly simpler if we think, rather than thinking about the environment in quantum mechanical terms, let's just for a moment think about it in classical terms. So it's providing basically thermal noise. That thermal noise means that the phase of the wave function at any particular point is fluctuating around quite a lot. So, in other words, the whole thing is pretty much like, I said you tie a string around, but this is more like the child's toy, a slinky. You know what a slinky is? It's this coil of very elastic wire, which, again, if you were to do that, tie that around your waist, you see, the whole thing can oscillate about like mad. So at any particular point, the angle would be almost totally undefined. Nevertheless, you still have this topological invariant here. So that'll work, provided that the wave function is constrained never to go to zero. Okay, if it goes to zero, that spoils the argument because now you can slip your face. It's like cutting the string. Now, that's the crucial difference between the helium in this annulus and the electron in the atom. For the electron in the atom, Schrödinger's equation is linear. There's nothing to prevent the wave function going to zero. And in fact, it does. If you just think about imagine that we have this electron in a p state in the atom, and imagine that it wants to decay to the s state. Okay? And for the moment, let's treat the electromagnetic field as classical. You get complications if you have to think about it quantum mechanically. So let's just think about it as classical for a moment. So the electron now has its own wave function, not entangled with anything. So now we can just write down an interpolation, A of t psi p of theta, psi, where that's the angle around the atom, plus B of t times psi s of theta. This is the p state with one turn, one 2 pi as I go around. This is the s state with no 2 pi. Right? They're topologically distinct. How's the system going to make a transition from one to the other? It's got to, at some point, drive at some time and some value of theta, the wave function has got to go to zero. Well, you can just do the calculation. It does. It always does. So that's how it makes this transition between these two topologically distinct states. Now, in the case of the helium, what's different is that for energetic reasons, it turns out, and this is not trivial, but it turns out that it's energetically very disadvantageous to drive the amplitude of the order parameter to zero. And so basically this guarantees you the metastability. If you go, if you can ever create a situation where the energy necessary to drive the order parameter to zero becomes very small, then you may be able to get around that by thermal fluctuations. And indeed, there are some beautiful experiments by John Repping and his collaborators in the late 70s which see that effect. You can do that. But there's one very neat thing about this, I think, which I rather like. All of this theory, not perhaps quite in the language I've described, all of this theory was sort of known since the work of Bloch sometime around, I don't know, 1950 or thereabouts, perhaps earlier. And so everyone said, you know, it's this, the reason you've got, you have this metastability is because of the topological constraints on the order parameter. For many, many years, that was sort of, in some sense, the end of the story, because the only kind of order parameter that people knew was the kind of order parameter that occurs in ordinary superconductors, like, say, aluminum or lead, and in liquid helium, just this complex scalar order parameter. Now, what's beautiful is that nowadays, now that we have all these cold atom experiments, we can actually do look at systems which have a more complicated order parameter. For example, the atoms in question can have spin. Now, at the moment they have spin, it turns out this argument completely goes away. Because what you can do is, by a clever combination of bending the spin and changing the orbital wave function, you can actually avoid this topological constraint. It's very specific to a simple complex scalar order parameter. Yes, I think I could try, and I would basically be repeating what Landau and Lifshitz said in 1936. But yeah, okay, yes, good. Well, okay, good. Imagine that I have a Hamiltonian or a free energy, which has a particular invariance property, and a typical example would say be the case of a Heisenberg ferromagnet, where the interactions between neighboring spins are isotropic. So this means the whole free energy is invariant under O3, the operation of the group O3. And in words, all directions in space are exactly equivalent. Okay, now it may happen that under certain circumstances this invariance appears to be violated. That is, the system may create for itself some kind of expectation value. In this case, it would be an expectation value of the magnetization, which is not invariant under rotation. In other words, the magnetization may pick out a particular direction. So we say that the usual language is that the symmetry has been spontaneously broken. And the order parameter is, crudely speaking, the thing which breaks the invariance. It's the physical quantity which takes a value which is, in some sense, in conflict with the original invariance. Now, of course, in real life, as you can imagine, it is the symmetry is not really spontaneously broken. There'll always be the odd magnetic field floating around the Earth's magnetic field or something of the kind, which will pick out a direction for it. But at least it looks as if, to a first glance, it looks as if you're breaking that. That symmetry, yeah. And the same. The same kind of idea happens when, say, a liquid crystallizes. Again, the original Hamiltonian is translationally invariant. The ground state of the crystal is not translationally invariant. Again, you've broken the symmetry. Now. In the case of superconductors and superfluids, this is actually, I think, a slightly tricky point. And it actually relates to something which I was intending to talk briefly about it anyway, so let me briefly talk about it. The symmetry which is often said to be broken in the superconducting or superfluid transition is the so-called U1 gauge symmetry. That is, the symmetry which says that I can take my wave function, let's just go back for a moment to a single particle problem. So I have a Schrodinger wave function there. Now, I know that one thing I can do, which is not going to affect any physical quantity, is just to multiply the wave function uniformly by some fixed phase. In other words, I will simply write that psi of x goes to e to the I phi psi of x, where phi is not a function of x. Okay. Now, you all know that that doesn't affect anything. And it doesn't affect any physical quantity. And of course you can do the same with many body wave functions. You can just, again, multiply them by an overall phase and nothing changes. And it's often said that it is this symmetry which is broken when you go into the superfluid or superconducting phase. That, to my mind, is a load of nonsense. It's highly misleading. And in fact, unfortunately, to my mind, this idea of spontaneously broken U1 symmetry has been taken much, much too seriously in the theory of superfluidity and superconductivity. There's an interesting asymmetry there, actually. In the theory of the superfluidity of, say, helium-4 or dilute Bose gases, at least until recently, there's a lot of the sort of classic work of people like Bloch, Feynman, you name it. With one exception, that's the work of Bogoliubov in 1948, none of this work has ever relied on the idea of spontaneously broken U1 symmetry. In the case of helium or a simple Bose system. In the case of superconductors, by contrast, the idea of breaking the U1 symmetry spontaneously was used by Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer in their original paper. And it was a very, very useful calculational tool. It turns out that, because what it does, you see, once you break the U1 symmetry, that allows you to have wave functions, many body wave functions now, which are actually superpositions of states with different n, with an equal to e to the I phi. And now, you see, if you really take that seriously, then phi does have a physical meaning, does have consequences, and so forth. And as I say, it just turned out that this idea of relaxing the constraint of conservation of total number of particles, that turned out to be extremely useful for the BCS calculation. You don't need it, in fact. You can do without it. In fact, in my book, Quantum Liquids, I do actually go out of my way. It's a bit clumsy, but I go out of my way to do without that, in fact. And you can get all the standard BCS results out that way. However, as I say, people have taken it very, very seriously. And this actually, I do have time to talk about this, because this is a very, rather important point, I think. This has the following consequence. Once I've, if I go through the standard textbook theory of superconductivity, relaxing this constraint on total particle number, etc., as most of the textbooks do, then I can ask, I start off from an even number parity ground state, that is a ground state which has an even number of electrons in it. And I have some kind of wave function which I can write for that, which indeed, if I follow the standard ideas, is a superposition of this form, with actually n only varies, as it were, mod 2. That is, I can have a superposition of even values of n here. Sorry. So perhaps I should, strictly speaking, call this sum of n equals even. Okay. Now, question. What are my first odd number parity states like? Okay. If I go through a very standard textbook discussion, it goes something like this. Okay, suppose I want to create one extra fermion there. I want to put in one extra fermion to my system. So I'm going from an even parity state to an odd parity state. What must I do? Well, according to the textbooks, what I must do is, first of all, to create, with some amplitude uk, an extra particle of momentum k. I just put in one extra fermion. But then here comes the tricky bit. They then say, yeah, but that's not enough. What I also have to do is to add to that a term of the form vk, another coefficient, times taking out a particle momentum minus k. And that's the standard textbook account of how I create a single fermion extra quasi-particle. And I'm allowed to do this, you see, because I indeed didn't start with a definite number of particles here. So if you believe that, it makes sense. Alas, turns out that at least in certain circumstances, this is really highly misleading. You can actually see this. There's a rather simple argument which shows that, at least in certain circumstances, this cannot possibly be right. And it relies essentially on a Galilean invariance argument. So this is probably going to be above above the heads of some of you if you're not familiar with the language of BCS theory. But let me just briefly sketch what goes on here. What goes on is that, I suppose I start with my condensate, that is my even parity ground state, even number parity ground state. I start with that at rest. I'm going to create a quasi-particle and with momentum k. And I do it, and lo and behold, the momentum comes out, as you might expect, the momentum comes out to be simply p equals h bar k. Now, I now imagine that I go to a frame moving with respect to the original one and repeat the operation. Now, the tricky point is that I now have to match a particle which now has some momentum k prime, so it's going to be in general different from k. I've got to match it, not with minus k prime, because that was only right when the condensate was at rest. I've got to match it with something which is, as it were, right from the frame of the, as viewed from the frame of the condensate. This is a standard textbook way of doing this. And you can do that, and you create your new quasi-particle as viewed from the moving frame. You calculate its momentum, alas, does not come out at the value which Galilean invariance requires for it. So something has gone wrong. Now, in this case, I think it's rather trivial to see what's gone wrong. What's gone wrong is that whenever you create your extra quasi-particle, you have to create with it, your extra hole. There's an extra particle, there's an extra hole. This is not going to conserve particle number. As I said, this business of relaxing conservation of particle number is a nonsense, so you want to not to do that, right? So you've got to now put in an extra Cooper pair here. Now, you see, in the original, when the condensate was at rest, putting in that extra Cooper pair really had, it was sort of trivial, it had no effect. When the Cooper pair is moving, it's going to contribute to the momentum. And sure enough, once you do that, everything comes out all right. So you, to my mind, when in doubt, one really should put in that extra Cooper pair. But now you see, now we see something really which is a bit worrying. Just about all the arguments in the literature concerning Majorana fermions and so forth have not put in that extra Cooper pair, and therefore they've obtained, for example, the result that a Majorana quasar particle in a Majorana fermion in a Fermi superfluid is its own antiparticle. Well, it may be, as long as you don't put this in. The moment you do, that destroys it. That's a very good question, and that's what we've been trying to look at for the last two or three years, actually. And I'll just give you my best guess on this. My best guess is it's going to be a disaster for a lot of the sort of one now standard results in the literature concerning the possibility of topological quantum computing using these beasts. So
the premise here is that you can't do anything to your system to change the particle number.
That's right. Well, you can, but you can't. Okay, thanks for raising it. Let's just think about that a little more. I said this whole idea of relaxing particle number conservation is a nonsense. Okay, I have to perhaps be a little more careful and say what exactly I mean by that. Suppose I have a completely closed system. So I have a metal block which is completely sort of floating in free space or whatever. Okay, then the number of electrons clearly is conserved, and so I certainly shouldn't try to make any superposition of states of different number of electrons. Now you say, okay, wait a minute, that's not in fact the real life case. The real life case is you've usually got leads on your sample. Surely that means that the particle number can fluctuate. Sure it can, but crucial point. As long as I look at, first of all, if I include the leads explicitly in my description, then the total number of electrons in the sample plus the leads is still going to be conserved. Right? Suppose I don't want to do that. Suppose I want to look at the system here and forget about the leads. Well, I can do that. A standard technique, I just write down a reduced density matrix of my system. But now, every time that the number of particles in the system changes, so does the number in the leads. So that means that when I trace over the description of the leads, my reduced density matrix for the system is proportional to rho n delta n n prime. So in other words, my density matrix can have diagonal elements which correspond to different n. What it can't have is off-diagonal elements in that description.
So you get a sort of a super selection rule on the...
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
is that clearly formalized anywhere? Is that...
Well, I think the best justification one could give is in terms of the basic quantum field theory, which you believe to describe your electrons. Now, I have to admit that there have been these papers by Aharonov and his co-workers some years ago, which claimed that you could make sense of these superpositions, you could violate this number superselection rule. One thing I'm very sure of is if you're going to do it, you better do it at the start of the whole operation. I mean, once you start off with a fixed number of particles, you're never going to be able to violate it. So I think I don't think that. This is something I really need to look at in a bit more detail. But I'm fairly sure that doesn't affect the argument. Okay. One last thing. I've just got 5 more minutes, so let me just introduce one more point, which is rather generic and I think rather important. We'll come back to that in various disguises later. We often have in condensed matter physics a situation where we know that the system is not isolated. Or the particular variable that we're looking at cannot be treated as isolated. It's certainly interacting with other parts of the system or other degrees of freedom. A typical example, if I have a flux qubit, a squid ring, the variable I'm usually most interested in is the total flux through the qubit, or what's essentially equivalent to the total circulating current. Now, I know for sure that there are other degrees of freedom around which are going to be interacting with that. And the question is, does this screw up the possibility of doing a decent quantum mechanical calculation of it? Now, as I say, we don't know. The trouble is that very often in real life, we simply don't know what these other degrees of freedom are, how strongly uncoupled to them, or whatever. Nevertheless, I do have a certain amount of information, and I get that, for example, from the dissipative terms in the equation of motion at the classical level. So I can, under certain circumstances, I can actually treat this flux qubit by a semi-classical description. And then if I do that, it'll have an equation of motion, which will have a dissipative term in it. So the question is, can I, in some sense, use that? And this is a rather complicated subject, but crudely speaking, the argument goes something like this. I certainly can't write down an exact Hamiltonian or Lagrangian for my system. I mean, almost by definition of a sort of complex condensed matter system, that's not going to be totally impossible. So I'm nowhere near the sort of degree of microscopic accuracy that I would be, say, if I were dealing with quantum optics or whatever. What I might be able to do, however, goes something like this. I might be able to stare at the classical equation of motion and derive from that a sort of sketchy Lagrangian or Hamiltonian, which will not be certainly not be adequate for all purposes, but will be adequate for discussing the quantum behavior that I'm interested in. I'll go into that in much more detail in the next lecture, actually, because I think it is an important topic. But crudely speaking, the idea is to work back from the classically observed dissipation, from that to get out enough of a microscopic description to deal with the quantum behavior. One case in which this was done with, I think, some success is the case of the quantum tunneling in a current Bias-Josephson junction. These are famous series of experiments by a lot of people, primarily John Clark and his group in Berkeley in the early 80s. You have a current Bias-Josephson junction, and if you just write down a purely conservative Hamiltonian for it, you can calculate the tunneling rate, the rate of quantum tunneling out of the zero voltage state. Well, it turns out that the actual rate is very much slower than this, by a factor of about 300. You can account for that if you take into account the dissipation, which is observed at the quasi-classical level in this Josephson junction. And it doesn't know where it comes from. It may come from the junction itself, it may come from the leads, whatever, but you have at least a phenomenological classical equation of motion for it. Now, you can, as I say, work back from that, write down a, I guess I'll go into that in more detail next time, write down a sketchy Hamiltonian of the interaction of the environment, the interaction with the environment, and you can then plug that into the formulae for quantum tunneling rate. You have to use some kind of functional integral method to do the calculation, but you can do it. And sure enough, it comes out beautifully in agreement with the observed value of the escape rate. So at least in that case and some similar ones, I think that technique does seem to work. So we do have a means of dealing with, in some sense, with these unknown sources of dissipation, provided that we can characterize them adequately by a term in the classical equation of motion. So I'll do that in more detail next time. Okay. Well, I don't know. People are going to have to let me know whether they like this rather discursive style or whether they'd rather have a more formal approach. Probably next lecture will be a bit more formal because I do have these slides and will perhaps be using them. But if you don't have any strong objections, I may talk around them and put in a few historical notes and so forth and spice things up. Well, that'll be the next, at least the next lecture, yes, and perhaps a bit more than that, yeah. And then, as I say, it's natural, if we're going to talk about the possible quantum information applications, it's natural to talk about the fractional quantum Hall effect, and also, to some extent, about exotic superconductivity, such as strontium ruthenate, and so forth. But as I say, please, yeah, let me reiterate, please, by next time, if you have something you want you want me to talk about, come prepared to tell me about it and see what we can do.